Okay, good evening. Thanks everyone for joining us this evening for the Curators Tour for Milford Graves, a mind-body deal organized with Ars Nova Workshop and the ICA. Of course, it's odd to give a curator tour from the comfort of my own home, but we will make do and sort of bring some maybe more Q&A into the tour than we would normally. Before getting tonight, we want to do a couple things. A, thank some of the funders for the exhibition, including the Pew Center for Arts and Heritage and the Andy Warhol Foundation, who made the exhibition possible. And just to set some goals to the future, make sure that people are aware that coming up, we will be having conversations with Rhea Combs and Greg Tate. We will be having a cafe and conversation around the issue of spirituality, another conversation with Jake Nussbaum, Susie Ibarra, and Will Calhoun, and the sort of official release of a special number of two works played by Jason Moran within the exhibition in Milford's honor. So we hope you all join us for those and come back and think more. So for tonight, instead of giving a traditional tour of being able to walk through piece by piece, room by room, Derek Rigby at the ICA has made a sort of 17-minute looping video with sound from the exhibition that we will start in a couple minutes, and it will play through, and it will be playing in the background while Mark and I talk. And about 20 minutes in, we'll bring in Professor Graves for a couple questions from us and from the audience. As usual, you can submit your questions in the chat and they will be put forward, and we hope we can get to as many people as we can within an hour. And for those of you who want, we will be playing just a little bit of sound from the video, but for those of you who would like to revisit the video later with its full sound, you can sort of just follow the YouTube link, which will also be in the chat. And we wanted to really start this tour by just like 3 minutes of sound from the exhibition, because there's been a lot of Zoom events about the conversation. There's been a lot of video footage. But one thing that's lost in a lot of the images and a lot of the Instagram posts and JPEGs is that the show is not as static as it might look in pictures. It's very a living, breathing sort of organism as it sort of blends with each other. And so what you will see, like for those who cannot hear, there will be images from the first gallery with, you will hear footage of some recordings of Milford Graves playing with Albert Eiler, recorded the song Bells. And then it'll transition into the room, which is more the lab and the sculptures. And you'll be hearing some of the heart sonification sounds that come out of lab view and the various heart studies that Milford's been doing with his computer. So with that, maybe you could start the video, Derek, and we will start talking in about 3 minutes.
Thank you.
Okay. So we just wanted to give people a little taste to know that this is a very lively atmosphere that you walk into. It sort of has sounds moving everywhere. It's not just that the sculptures have a collage of materials, but there's actually a lot that sort of unfolds as you go through the space. And so I guess I just wanted to maybe start from a basic question, having been with you sort of all along for this ride, Mark. What brought you, I know you're usually a music presenter, you do things night after night, a variety of venues, and you had interest in, we've been involved in exhibitions together, and you had interest in being more involved in sort of looking through an exhibition as a curator. I wonder what brought you to, you know, Milford being the right choice for your first large, large exhibition.
Yeah, well, Happy New Year, Anthony.
Right.
Good to be here, thanks. You know, I could have let this video keep going. It was, even though I've been, you know, spent a lot of my entire 2020 around these works and even with Milford, and of course, organized this thing, you know, it never gets old. There's always, even for me, something to experience here. And it's nice to take kind of a slow look at it, like this video is allowing us to do. I haven't actually told, I don't think, a lot of people this, but probably in 2013, 2014, I was trying to, I was working really hard at organizing an exhibition around Peter Broetzmann and Han Benek. You know, they are both visual artists, almost on par with their extraordinary music and improvising chops. And the more research and the more digging I did, the idea that there might be another artist, a third artist, in this, you know, I think Han Benek and Peter Broetzmann are in a way traditional visual artists and musicians at the same time. Their lives have since very young men have been interwoven, and they have very interesting and similar and intersecting stories to tell. And it was almost, you know, after spending years working on that and not really getting anybody to invest in it, you know, you begin to maybe stray and think about that third artist who is kind of popping into the conversation that you were having, generally, you know, only with yourself, and that was Milford, Milford seemed like such a mystery, a mysterious figure to me. I'd spent decades listening to his music, of course, as a fan and a presenter. And that same year, really coincidentally, we invited Milford to Philadelphia to perform at Bartram's Garden, the birthplace of American botany. No better place for Milford to perform than in the oldest barn in Philadelphia County. And it was magical. From that point, I found myself gravitating towards him and finding opportunities to email him or call him or visit him. And he was very, giving and open to the ideas of an exhibition. And they slowly developed, very slowly. They developed in a way, I think, that was the sort of, I think they developed in a way that allowed me to experience so-called scholarship in a way that was right for me, and certainly right for him, and you know, allowed me to connect with his entire cosmology. And then, you know, well, we spent a lot of time and energy and brought that, you know, ultimately to Philadelphia. You know, I do want to also, I'm sorry to say, I want to say one more thing. I don't know if I'm answering the questions here, but you know, today it's interesting. Today the NEA announced a new program called Sound Health Network, which is exciting and amazing, and they're talking about the burgeoning field of music and sound and health and science. And you know, I'm excited to, you know, to see what directions they go in and how they support multidisciplinary conversations and activities. But I think about Milford, who's been doing this for a very long time, many decades, you know, a reel-to-reel tape and a stethoscope, you know, when those technologies were the most advanced. So, you know, why now?
Well, you know, to follow that question, I think we organized the exhibition as if you sort of enter his house and you go through the different ways that knowledge develops when you spend time, mm-hmm. you know, around Milford's concerns. And so, you know, for myself, I think we go from the first room with pictures of the house to then the second room with the sculptures and the lab view videos and then the sonography sounds. And I don't know if people, I'm gonna assume people don't know this, but back in the 18th century, a new medical form was developed called percussion. And the idea was that the body was a resonant membrane and that you would thump on the patient's body with your ear on them to be able to hear where the disease was. And this was specifically for diseases of the lungs and the heart. And this was to replace what had been the way to figure out diseases of the heart and lungs before that, which was from Hippocrates, which was you would shake a person and hear where they sounded differently in their sort of resonant chest with your ear against them. And so the fact that percussion has a tie to the heart ever, always, you know, going back to the 18th century, I mean, always, but in Western medicine, it's tied to the 18th century. And then we developed the stethoscope from this idea of thumping on chests as a sort of way to get more sound into the ear. And for myself, as a fan of Milford, you know, going back to the 90s, you know, for decades, I guess, was that it always struck me that when I first heard that first recording, which was Eiler's Love Cries, the first record I heard that he was on, you know, it's like, it's amazing to think that the way that he was stamping, scraping, striking, you know, shaking, you could hear the rubbing, you could hear the plucking of the drums, you could hear a very physical understanding that we're talking about a reverberant resonant space. And I do think we were conscious, and maybe you can talk more about, like, we wanted the space to have a resonance, right? Bodies are resonant, the heart's resonant, the music's resonant, the way the knowledge is shared, and Milford's sort of diasporic combination of, you know, sort of thoughts and ideas that we might identify with an Afro-Caribbean lineage, as well as Western medicine, as well as martial arts from across Asia, as well as everything. So maybe, I mean, I don't know, maybe you do you have thoughts about the exhibition being a sort of resonant experience?
Sure. Yeah, I think that many understand Milford as a drummer, as a jazz or so-called free jazz musician, and they may have even done what we all do, which is limit them to that role, much like many jazz musicians have been limited by the role of the drum set. That you know, Milford clearly threw out the window very quickly. So you know, the exhibition has sounds from a life in music and an extraordinary life in music and performance. But this exhibition, it really only scratches the surface of his life and performance. So you're seeing what not only what freedom looks like, but what freedom sounds like in a variety of extraordinary explorations and paths that this man takes, whether it's in cardiology, whether it is in cross-cultural partnerships with Mintanaka in Japan, whether it's the sculptural work, which is relatively new, or whether it's the sonifications that we mentioned earlier, and I hope we can talk to Professor a little bit about those, maybe in even more technical terms later. The exhibition is an experience. It is, it's not an exhibition you want to have a conversation while you're visiting with your friend. It really is an immersive experience, and you are moving through many sounds and many worlds and many disciplines, really. Milford's mind and energy never separated them, and the exhibition, although it separates them, they are bleeding into one another, I think that Milford would actually appreciate that. But speaking about sound and musicians, improvising and the white box, you Anthony have done an interesting amount of work with musicians and improvisers, even so-called jazz musicians, who have found their way into the museum setting, some obvious and some not obvious, from Tony Conrad to Sun Ra to the work of the AACM. There's even some, some rumors that you're talking to, Ardo Lindsay. So, I wonder, what the thinking is here. Is this just a coincidence? You love this music as much as I do, of course, but that doesn't always translate into opportunities that find themselves in a place like the ICA.
Okay, before I answer your question, I'll just remind people that you can drop questions into the chat or into the Q&A, which we will be opening up just shortly. And I guess to answer your question, Mark, there would be several fold. I mean, I think there's very few inventions that America has really excelled at and put a distinct stamp on besides improvisation. And I think it's hard to underestimate the importance of improvisation just as a person. I mean, to a certain degree, any conversation you have between two people is improvised because you have to listen to the person, respond to what they say, feel what that energy is between the two of you. And, but it's also in the way that, how do you solve problems? How do you, there's the old phrase, if the only tool you have is a hammer, you see every problem as a nail. Improvisation is one way to get out of your role of where you see your problems and what you see the limits of your knowledge. Mm-hmm. And in terms of the people that I've turned to, I mean, musicians, particularly jazz musicians, have been put in a corner for way too long that has not recognized how cross-disciplinary their work has often been, whether it's language or theater or visual art or, you dance, movement. I would also say that I have a particular interest, as a curator, in that it sounds really dumb, but who you call an artist defines what art is. Mm-hmm. And so if you're only calling people artists that have already walked into that role, art's going to follow a very neat path. But if you start saying, maybe this person's an artist too. Maybe that person is an artist too. You start opening up a whole lot of interesting avenues to think through how, you know, interdisciplinarity isn't, it's not a two-way street. It's a, it's like a roundabout with 32 off ramps, mm-hmm. you know, and it's coming in and coming out. And so it's really to try to think through these questions of, let's just see what is. What if Milford's an artist? What if Yara and the documentation of Yara is an amazing, you know, 20, 30 year experiment of what it is to think about yourself, what it is to think about yourself with others, collaborating with others, inventing movements, responding to others, and then sharing that documentation and sharing that experience with each other. Now we can look at it and ask that question, thanks to the fact that Milford so dedicatedly decided to personally document and capture what was going on in that house and in the dojo and through the years. So it just seems like an interesting experience. It's also, you know, the interesting thing is, like, I don't believe there's such a thing as an art world, because when you talk to artists, all visual artists are reading something, watching something, listening to something. So there's no walls anyways. The walls are only about market or delineation. They're not about what people are actually doing in their home. I just got distracted by the video, but now I'll try to get back on point. And I will say it's 6:53. Do you think now is maybe a time for us to start 50% us, 50%?
Yeah.
Mr. Graves?
I think the world is asking for him.
Okay.
I do want to say one more thing. I don't mean to transition on a heavy topic here, but I do think that you know, perceptions and resources and rights and these sorts of things, they always have flown along you know, racial lines and mm-hmm. They give some of us restrictions and give others, you know, uninterrogated power. So I think about the way race is an extraordinary force in our lives and has limited, movements and imaginations. And I think about how this extraordinary person has not been, there's no evidence that their movements quite literally have been limited, or nor their imagination. I think it's an important thing I wanted to just say today.
I mean, it is important. I mean, when I think about that question of, you know, who you call an artist, it's like, we know who's often been called an artist for, well, not just decades, but millennia. And that's, it's an effort to change. So.
Questions are rolling in. Keep them coming. And
let's bring in Professor Graves.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So, but Anthony, I'm gonna roll with some of these questions, actually.
Go for it.
Professor, there are a number of new drawings in the show. I would love for you to talk generally about them, but this is not the first time this has come up, or somebody has asked, but somebody here tonight is asking about your use of color. I had a conversation with Susie Ibarra just last week, and she was seeing photographs of the installation. She's thinking about your drums. She's thinking about the new drawings and the mural at home, and even the beautiful, backdrop that you're sitting in right now, which looks like a Milford Graves artwork. So can you speak about your use of color? This person, Julie, is also saying the energies of various pigments and how they reverberate in the eye and for the body.
Well, colors have always fascinated me. And as I said in previous talks, that I see something, and if it attracts me, I'm driven towards it. I don't question like why I like a light blue or orange or red, pink, yellow, brown, any of those colors. I don't question it. It just attracts me. And I let my eye be the decision maker. And I don't try to make these decisions off what somebody has systematically said, well, this color's like this or like that, even in the light spectrum. You know, if I want to go from a yellow or up to a violet, an ultraviolet or whatever, I don't try to use that system. I use my system of what makes me feel like, it makes me feel very comfortable and relaxed. It's very simple. Just listen to yourself. Listen to what you feel. Those paintings are basically how I cause my hand to vibrate through various different types of techniques, transducers, to be able to transfer a sound onto drawing paper. And then I do freehand, but I do transition types of motivated coloring patterns. I may put a whole bunch of different paints together and then let the drawing pad or whatever we're drawing on, I let it vibrate. And the vibration will make all kinds of different designs, but they're relative to how the sound is vibrating in general from the melody that we produce. So the combination of things that I'm doing here.
If I may ask, I mean, the drawings are brand new in the show. And when we say brand new, yes, they're days before the exhibition opened.
Yes.
But if we go back to some of the earliest stuff that's in the show, there's also the hand-painted albums.
Right, right.
So what brought you to just decide that I want to paint my albums myself from that initial moment? What got you to that jump?
Well, I'll tell you what happened. When I initially recorded the Yale University recordings, there was a friend of mine, Jan Tilton, who was a great painter, and he was from the Netherlands, but he was a really accepted painter there and trumpet player. And so he was so famous in the Netherlands, they used his painting for a stamp, one of the national stamps in the Netherlands. And so I was talking with Jan. I said, Jan, Don and myself is gonna do these recordings. And we're gonna distribute these on our own because we wanna be very creative. We didn't wanna be dictated to how it should be done, when it should be done or whatever. So I said, Jan, I don't have any covers. He said, no problem. So he ordered me these covers. So I said, Jan, I have another problem. I have empty covers you sent me, but we don't have the funds to make labels. So he just said to me, paint what you want on the labels. I said, paint what I want on the labels. So I got a hold of Don and got some acrylic paint, and I started listening. And I just let my hand go free. But my hand, the way I was painting it, I was dancing to what I heard. Because as a drummer, I was always told that you should be able to do foot movement to the rhythms that you play. So we never played just a rhythm without moving our feet, which caused me to do all kind of motion techniques on the rhythm itself, such as pressure techniques on the skin, sliding techniques would make it non-temporal type of times. It would just be sounding, some people say, oh, he's not playing in tempo, and so on and so on and so on. But however, we start painting, and then I gave him, I let Jan see him. He said, wait a minute, man, you are a painter. It blew Jan away. I said, oh yeah? So I decided to paint a lot of those covers. I mean, basically those covers, I did probably the majority of the covers. I think Don was kind of shy and trusting himself to make those designs. I just let my hand go, and I was playing the drums. And so that's going to take me out of a non-temporal kind of aspect of drumming. And then they became a specialty item. People wanted these hand-painted covers. And so that's how that started.
Do you remember how many you painted?
At that time?
Yeah.
Maybe about, I don't know, 15 or 20. And I gave up. I should have given up. So right now I said, you know what? Let me get back into that old groove again. The painting the covers. So I have some blank covers here, and I'm going back into the way I used to do it. Because they became very popular. Which they cost more than the regular cover, though. That's for sure.
For sure.
And it definitely cost more than the regular. So that's how that really started. It started by not being able to afford labels, and Jan said, do your own. But he was such an inspiration. He said, man, you're blowing me away, man. He said, you are actually an artist, man. John said that. I said, I'm going to go for it. Because that was a super high compliment from a guy who was an accomplished painter. It just blew him away.
Yeah, those are quite the collector's item now.
Yes, I know. We got a more updated new version, you know, of that particular thing. But that's pure gut feeling, man. And like I'm saying, I'm dancing. I'm really dancing on the covers. So if I hear the music and then hear the melody, it's telling me to go, I would do what we used to call rhythmic writing. Before I had any kind of mechanical device, I used to pull a piece of paper. I used to pull a piece of paper like it was on a drum, a rolling drum. And as I'm pulling it across, I would tap my finger and like, blah, 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 blah. And that was my original tracing. That was a homemade oscilloscope. That's how it came about.
Someone out there is asking if you remember doing any artwork as a child.
Oh yeah. I was a kid who my teacher used to always ask me to do the drawing for the class. It wasn't like I didn't know how to do artwork. I just didn't do it. And I didn't see the connection. But with the music, when like I said, Don, when I was inspired to do it, that was the driving force. Now, it wasn't like I couldn't draw. Actually, I must be in a draw me contest. I entered that, and I took a. I think fifth place. That was a little kid. A little kid.
Do you remember what you drew?
What did I do? What did I do? Good question. I probably got stuff in my pile. I got so much stuff I still gotta find. Packed away.
Oh, don't tell me that.
really packed away. I gotta find this stuff, man. I got envelopes and boxes and stuff. There's in there hidden in there someplace.
All right, we hear it. We're everybody's out here listening to that, and we want to see it.
Right, yeah, we'll come back for you. We'll come.
Yeah. Huh?
So we're going to change direction a little bit. Anthony Wilson, he's a former student of yours, professor. He said he's always been struck by the way you work across the various different activities and how they end up creating a sense of unity, of being one thing. It's almost as if you sensed early on that you were building something, an integrated structure. Is that the way you thought of it? Or was it more a matter of simply following each interest and letting them live side by side, trusting that they would integrate?
Yeah, I think that's it, second part. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Trusting how they integrate.
I want to move back to the drawings for a little bit. The seven drawings made it into the exhibition. You know, one of them dealt with thrust, motion, and a few of them dealt with other topics. I'm wondering. I know that you weren't necessarily working on them to include in the exhibition,
right?
But you spend time at home, even if it's only for your own benefit, making drawings and thinking through your own ideas and even using markers and pen and pencil and paper to put your thoughts down. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, basically, I got into the groove again, man. I got into the groove again. It's something I said, oh, let's go for it, man. Let my hands flow. It's doing it on the drum skin, so why don't I do it on a piece of paper? Mm-hmm. That's what happened. I just got into the groove, man. Like I'm saying, sometimes when you try to that's when it was when you did something, that's when you get stale. Mm-hmm. You're thinking too much. I'm saying just trust yourself, man. I can't say that more than what, I don't know how to say it other than that, man. You know, you do it and you like it, man. You don't like it, you don't like it. I just know that the drum skin itself has all these different kind of ways it vibrates. So if the skin is vibrating like that, why would you make a painting that is all done in a way, man, that everything is so linear, man? You know they don't follow the rebounding or the general motion of a drum skin, and when you follow the motion of a drum skin, you're gonna find yourself, man, making all kind of angular movements, and that's what it's about. And that's the more truer way, and not doing it in a standard way where everything is laid out for you, man, and you can't deviate from playing in a tempered mode, man. Mm-hmm. To me, that's not the way to do it, because you're not following the orders of how a skin vibrates.
Did that at all?
It's a dance again.
Did that at all affect the way that you painted your drums and the sort of the way that built your drums and made the drums?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. That's right. The painting the drum is based off the dance and the motion of how the drum skin vibrates.
There are a lot more questions coming in, so I want to get to as many of them as possible. Vanessa is actually asking about electronic music. and what your thoughts are on electronic music. But I want to also add a second part to that question. When you come and see this exhibition and you experience some of the sculptures and the lab view oriented stuff, you're hearing a lot of sounds, you're hearing these interesting, beautiful electronic musical sounds coming from the objects, coming from the some of the videos. And we understand that to be out of the laboratory of Professor Milford Graves. We know that you understand it as tonal rhythmology, and it would be great to hear how you define that.
Well, first of all, I don't do electronic music in the sense that I'm synthesizing in a way that I produce music that's not related to a hard sound. People do that. They synthesize all this kind of melodies and stuff like that. That's not really hard sound music. That's the electronic guys do that stuff. Mm-hmm. What I do is, first of all, take a hard sound. And the way I figured that out was that you have a basic type of premature arrhythmia beat. And these beats come about through motion, and they are found when you mix an adult heartbeat with an infant heartbeat. The infant heartbeat is usually twice as fast as an adult heartbeat. If you go on ba boom, ba boom, ba boom, ba boom, and then within that same time frame, you may have a premature beat, ba boom, ba boom, ba boom, ba boom, ba boom, ba boom. Now, if you go through the kind of emotional situation, then you have a mixture, man. You have a mixture of ba boom, ba boom, boom, boom. They're not pathological unless you can predict when a premature beat is coming. But if they're spaced out, that means what you have to do is learn how to calm the system down or play counter rhythms like that or stimulate certain points. But this is all the way a hard sound vibrates. In other words, I may not ask for, if I'm vibrating a hard sound, I take the waveform and said, I want to measure on that waveform, say like 5 milliseconds. Then I can amplify that 5 milliseconds. And that's going to cause it to take on a different kind of rhythm. Now, when you're playing like bata, and the bata music out of Cuba, you hear more of the. But when you hear that constant, that's pathological. So I'm always telling the bata players, watch out that when you play that rhythm, you're not causing some sympathetic response from the heart itself. So it's a matter of isolating different parts of the original heart sound. And when you put those together and connect them, you will get a melody coming out. Very unique, very different, man. You know, so that's the whole key to doing that. And so I built these, heart sounds. And they're based off of, I'm getting this, you know, with words again here. This sectional, I'll say sectional portions of a heart sound. And when you put those together, I may ask for 30 this time. I say, okay, well, I want to changing, whereas after 100 milliseconds, I mean, after 200 milliseconds or 300 milliseconds, then if I isolate certain areas, bring the voltage up, and that part of the heart sound is going to give me a different rhythm. So when you take a heart sound and start breaking it all up in different parts like that, you're not going to no longer get a just ba-boom, ba-boom, or ba-boom-boom. It's going to come ba-boom, 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 ba-boom. So, but it's all there. It's unbelievable. All those melodies are located in that heart sound. The key to it is being able to sectionalize it off, increase certain parts of the waveform that's very low, you don't hear it. But if you can take that section and increase it up, then you're in business. You start to hear a melody. That's what that's about. But it's there.
Can I follow a question? Thinking through the explanation that you just gave and the sort of like wonderful ways that you sort of led us through the heart rhythms.
Right.
There's a question that came through in the chat. And I want to sort of add on to that to just sort of ask like how you've thought about how you use your voice in performance, how you use your voice as a rhythmic event, as a melodic event, because you're quite distinctive in the way that you sing often in your performances, in your lectures, the way you sort of get rhythmic with your voice. Okay. So how you think about using your voice?
I use my voice like this. I try to understand the anatomical location of certain kinds of an anatomical location of certain kind of ways that the voice vibrates. Let me see if I got this straightened out. In other words, I had to make a decision. Well, my voice. Let me get together because I'm trying to simplify this so it's not so complex. In other words, I think about when I'm first opening my mouth. You know, I try not to use a language in a sense. I use a whole phonetic system. So if I said, so what's the whole process of the intake of nutrients into your body? A breath into your body. So initially when you open your mouth, I have to use some sort of phonetical term or whatever that's going to force my lips to open up. You understand? So ba. So if I say ba, I'm opening them up, ba. When I say ba, if I say let me give a good here. If I say let me see. Oh, I can say ba. I say ra, I say ba ra, ba ra, ba di. That's what I'm saying, ba di. I'm so looking at that area. That's stimulating different areas within the vocal system in the body. It may stimulate the nasal area, you know, the recent area. Like if I say one, ha, da, ha. If I go all the way down to ha, 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 I know that's a lower sound, okay? That's a lower sound that's going to stimulate the lower part of the whole process of what's being stimulated. Basically, it comes down, this is kundalini. Without, so you understand what I'm saying? I'm following the whole pathways of how sound is traveled throughout the body. If I say ha, ra, if I say ra, ha, rum, 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 I'll be in my nasal, rum, rum. So I'm trying to get the nasal area to vibrate. So I'm connecting all of those together to be able to trace the way they would do like a kundalini. And so I don't have to say a specific kind of language in a sense. I give it the phonetic language. When you say that particular sound, where does it vibrate within the whole anatomical system of the body? Some is in the throat, some is down and to the up abdomen, some is in solar plexus, some is down in that's it. You just follow that. So if I'm saying, if the sound comes in, I may open it up with da, da, da. I'm gonna get my lips open. Da, da. So if I know if I do that, my mouth is open, and that's my whole intake of the food, because that's what it's gonna really come down to be. How do we get that food into the body? Where does it go to? The solar plexus is very powerful, because once I get down to the solar plexus area right there, that is causing the celiac region in there to be able to stimulate liver and kidney energetics. I follow that whole pathway. You see, so this time I'm going back and forth and I'm tracing the whole concept. In other words, I'm taking all of the phonetic sounds and not abstracting them like you do in kundalini. And I want my whole body to stimulate. So that sound is coming through the lips, going down to the body, coming back up, going to the nasal region, and then releasing itself. And when you do that, how you feel is powerful. Now here's the key. I have to electronically stimulate these points. But we stimulate specific points on the body. Okay, they could be and back of the neck. They can be in the temporal area. They can be in the frontal area, any parts of the brain. What that does, that sends signals. That sends signals to see if we can make any adjustments and how the heart is responding to it. And how we can take these arrhythmias and change them all around. And get good tone, get good balance to it, man. So when I try to do that, it's a confirmation that I feel like doing. If I feel like going from the mouth area all the way down to the gut and then coming back up, as long as I know where each phonetic is producing this most profound effect and stimulating that part of the body, then they come out there. It's still that's how I do it. It don't have to be a language per se. The importance to know is the anatomical, you understand, location. Mm-hmm. And how they're stimulating parts in the whole cranial part of the brain, man. That's extremely important. Sounds more simple, you know, but it's a little complex, you know. Just gotta know what you're doing. And the way I have LabVIEW set up, that's all set up like that.
There is someone, I think, you know, who Dennis was asking about the relationship between, you know, and I know you addressed this a little bit just now, but he's asking about the relationship between the conscious and the unconscious, especially when it comes to performance.
Conscious and unconscious. What are we talking about here? I don't understand that.
Yeah, well.
What do you want to know?
That's a good question.
Conscious and unconscious? Am I conscious of what I'm doing? Anyone conscious of what I'm doing? There's no difference.
There's no difference between the conscious and the unconscious?
They're all one, man.
There we go.
Yeah.
We all one. Why are we separating?
We have an opportunity maybe for one more question if people have it. Dennis, who asked that question, he said, I hear you now.
We did have a question of who inspires you. So I don't know if you could easily sum up people, performers, anybody that inspired you to take the path that you took. That might be too big of a question, but maybe, you know, maybe we can, you know, come to mind.
Mainly is the one I've said, is it had to deal with those particular adult heart rhythms versus the more premature ones. Adult versus the infant one. I'm sorry. Because you got twice the ratio in there, you know? That happens, man. When you're in an emotional setting, you will get, you know, those two types of patterns going on. As long as they're not symmetrical, it is fine. But when they're symmetrical, you're in trouble, man. You can't keep repeating yourself. As long as they're spaced out. That's nature gave us that. Nature gave us that. That's right there. Not easy to answer these questions because this is all through demonstration. Just listening to this, it doesn't maybe gel as much as you're actually seeing this thing take place, how things are done, and hearing it, man.
Well, there's a lot of appreciation and love and amens and truth coming in the chat. This is not the first time we've had Professor Graves on Zoom, and it's not going to be the last time. I think we have to end it right here.
Yes.
There will be more.
Yes, okay. and a reminder to everyone: there are events next week. I believe there's on the 24th, there's definitely an event, two events. There's Coffee and Conversation and a Jason Moran video that will be released. There's a conversation with Ray Combs and Greg Tate that is scheduled and on the ICA website soon. And there is a event that we need to reschedule with Jake Nussbaum, Susie Ibarra, and Will Calhoun. So please visit the exhibition, visit us again in Zoomland, and share with us our appreciation of Milford Graves, and all of you for joining us.
Good night.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.